My top, two of my top artists, to me, the two artists that I can say are some of the greatest of all time, Bob Marley, Stevie Wonder. The list goes on and on and on, like, but Bob Marley, Stevie Wonder. And for me, when I talk about female MCs, I've always said Lauryn Hill. Everybody knows that I'm a tremendous Lauryn Hill fan. Because to me, when I judge a female MC, first of all, Lauryn Hill can sing. Okay, like can really like, really, really like sing. And she can rap, but it's also her lyrical content. And I was even watching something where she said, you know, as a writer, it comes very easily. Like I could, we could write as writers, like we can write pretty much anything. But the challenge is saying how good is what we're putting out there for the target audience. And there's a conflict because it's like, I'm a human being, right? I'm a human being and I go through things. Like when I was going through my lyrics last night, I was like, man, there's a lot of stuff about this. There's a lot of stuff that people will look at as kind of not good for the community, you know, because of the things that I've been going through, the attack that has been on my life and all of the things that I've been going through. I took all that and I said, you know, at least I have a creative outlet rather than going out and physically harming the people that I believe have been threatening my life. I have this creative outlet, right? That's not really what this conversation is about. So I have this admiration for Lauryn Hill as an artist. But I was thinking, like, what if I were to come across Lauryn Hill and finally meet her and tell her how much I love her, I love her music, how much I respect her as an artist, how much, you know, her artistry has impacted my life. And if I asked her, you know, Lauryn, would you be my mentor? I want to be your protege. And she looked me dead in my eyes and says, absolutely not. I have no desire to be around you. You are basic and you are beneath me. I would be probably pretty hurt. Now, how would I respond? As a pupil, I could say, there's various responses. I could go after my feelings are hurt and go back to where I'm from and trash her name. I met Lauryn Hill. She's the most egotistical, arrogant, blah, 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 and trash her name, right? And say, I'm no longer a fan. But an individual with discernment was like, time out. An hour ago, you were a fan of hers. Now you're not a fan of hers? But her music is still the same. The quality of her music, her lyrical ability is still the same. She still can sing and dance and all of the criteria. Like, you were a fan of her artistry, right? Yes. So now you're not a fan of her because she said that you're beneath her, but her artistry is still the same as it was an hour ago? Or what I could do is say, Miss Hill, why do you feel like I'm beneath you? Why do you feel like I'm basic? And I could listen to her perspective. And I could use that to become better, to become stronger. I think that your lyrics are basic. I don't like the way you dress. You're not unique enough. Whatever it is. Oh, okay. And I could use that to become better, right? Or she could say, you know, I said that. Not because sincerely from my heart that I really feel that way, but I think that you are arrogant. And I wanted to put you in your place to let you know that there are people that are way more masterful than you are, and you need to be humbled. And my response to that likely what I would say. If that was the case, I would say, how do you feel I'm, why, how do you feel that I'm arrogant? And if she said something vague, like your attitude, I would have to say, can you please be more specific? What behavioral tendencies specifically do you feel like is arrogant? And if she were to say, you know, I had to humble you because arrogance is an attribute of the shaitan, and I only keep godly company. It's a tragic flaw, right? It's an attribute of the shaitan, and I only keep godly company, and I feel like it's a tragic flaw of you, so I had to let you know that you're basic and you're beneath me. I would have to say, well, okay, that's your perception. Please let me know why you feel I'm arrogant. Well, I feel like you're arrogant because of these reasons, this behavior. And then I would have enough information from her as far as behavioral tendencies from her perception that I would need to fine tune or curtail. I could go back to the drawing board with enough information to be able to continue my ever long life work of self-betterment and self-refinement, which doesn't stop until I die. None of us are perfect people. But in order for me to even extract information from an individual, I would have to assess them as respectable. And I think that that is what one thing that as pupils, we do have the option of, the choice of. When selecting a mentor, that is someone who's overall you want to maybe replicate their success, their attitude, their disposition, their creative content, their karmic imprint, their sense of righteousness, all of these things, right? And there may be somebody who's masterful in their craft, but and feels like you should want to be their protege, but you may not respect them. You may not respect their content. You may not respect the way they carry themselves. You may not respect. So that is not a person that you are necessarily trying to pick their brain, because you understand that the way that they see things is not the way that you want to see things. You don't want to necessarily replicate or mimic them. For whatever reason, they could be successful in their career or whatever, but that could also be accompanying, like, they could be depressed, they could be miserable, they could be hateful, they could have, you know, all of these things, could be in karmic debt, they could be unrighteous, they could not have, you know, the Most High's favor. So if you value the Most High's favor, right, you say, no matter what, no matter how successful I become, I have to have the favor of God. I have to be in alignment with my God, right? And you see somebody who's got success, but they don't have God's favor, you might not want to pick their brain to figure out how they got where they got necessarily. If any of the choices that they've made drew them closer away from what it is that you personally prioritize. And what you may find when it comes to mentors or people that you look up to, that they may actually be even angry with you for you not evaluating them as somebody that you would look to seek guidance from. But again, that is your choice, right? That is your choice. So the first alternate, right, where the person goes and they say, I met Lauryn Hill and she's an egomaniac, she's egotistical and all these things. I just want to see her fall. I want to see her fall flat on her face. Because this is, you know, from my assessment, I don't know Lauryn personally, but this was when she had the tax situation and things like that. I believe that it was coerced and orchestrated as an attack against her life, maybe for that reason. It was multiple reasons. It was actually, for me, it was the way I see it was spiritual, because she's been dedicated to righteousness. So the attack on her life was, you know, from some wicked forces who really had an issue with what she was pushing. But also this idea of when you are in alignment with, and you know that you're masterful and you know that you're good, you know you're here to do God's work, and you have a certain air and disposition because you don't get that good with allowing a whole bunch of distractions to come into your life. So you're like, okay, I gotta quickly assess, is this person here to assist me and propel me, or is this person here to distract me and deter me? And people can very well misconstrue that high level of focus as arrogance, to say like, look, I don't even have time to talk to you. People are like, oh, well, they're arrogant. No, I don't have time to talk to you because I have work here to do. Your conversation is not gonna help me get to the work that I have here to do. Call me whatever you want, right? Why is it your job to humble that human being? Why not have the attitude of, well, you know, from my perspective, she's arrogant. Life will probably teach her. Why is it my job now to humble her? Especially if I haven't necessarily learned the valuable lesson of humility myself. Like Dame Dash says, everybody wants to humble somebody, but who's humbling them? So I want to take this conversation in two directions. One direction is, okay, I have this class that I take weekly, and it's ballroom dance. And if you saw me take the class, you might laugh at me like, she's a dancer? Because I've gotten progressively better, but I literally, like, it's a very difficult class for me, because organically the way that I dance, and I'm more of a creative, I'm more of a choreographer than I am a dancer. Like, I create dance. Following dance is a little bit more difficult. So if you saw the class, you'd probably like laugh at me, because it's like, I'm not, you know, that is like, this is not organically how I move. But the humbling part of it is like the fact that it's such a challenge for me. It's the most challenging dance class of the week. And I'm like, yes, I have something to conquer. I love it. Like, being the worst one in the room is actually kind of exciting, because it's like, now you're thirsty to master, and you're like, I have so much work to do. So this instructor, her personality is, her thing is theater. Broadway is like her thing. Like, she's like seen like every single play, like every single musical, like a million times. She's always at the theater. Like, all she talks about theater, 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 theater. And she's talking about her life and her stories, and she's had this incredible life, and she's an incredible dancer, like incredible ballroom, tango, flamenco, that type of stuff. So, and she's all about the theater, all about theatricalness and the spectacularness of it all. And I eat it up, I love it. But her personality to the naked eye could seem sort of abrasive, right? But she has this gift, right? And she has this gift as a masterful dancer that you want. As a less masterful dancer, you haven't reached that level of mastery. And even if you're good, you haven't reached that level of mastery. So what is wise? As someone with true high self-esteem, wisdom is to take be a little bit more humble. And that's coupled with balance. You're not gonna be somebody's doormat, and you're not gonna let somebody disrespect you. But bottom line is, they've got something to give to you that you want. And that's the art of whatever it is that you're trying to obtain. And you can apply this to any category. if we talk about corporate, you have an opportunity to sit down with the owner. You don't own a company. They do. It may not be a bad idea to have an attitude of, and so for whatever reason, you know, my family, I come from a Liberian family, and it's big on reverence and it's big on respect. But some people, some old, you know, just because you're old doesn't mean that you're respectable. There are old tricksters, there are old swindlers who frankly have just become more masterful at deception because they've been doing it long enough. But the culture is very much about respect. Respect of the elders, knowing your place as a child. Now, there are elders that take advantage of that, who are not respectable but demand respect. However, this is something that what culturally, you can look at this as in any single culture. The master of martial arts may even know who you are before they even take you on as their protege. They already know that you're the golden child. They already know that you've got the gift. They already know that when they give you these skills that you're going to take it to the next level. But even as the golden child, do you think that if you approach the master with a disposition of, I can kick your butt, and an arrogance and a lack of respect that they're going to gift you with the art, you really think so? So some people may say, you know, for whatever reason, they may look at it, I don't know, culturally they may look at it as, oh, when you show respect, that it's like cooning or what? Like what? That's nonsensical. It is within every single culture, as far as my observation, you can talk about even like back in the day, the idea of a teacher's pet. That person's a teacher's pet because the teacher has something to teach them. And this is something that you can find in literally every single culture. Go to West Africa. They're not teaching you the African sciences. If they feel like you have an attitude that is not. So there is a certain level of humility that comes with it, but you also have the power as a pupil to assess if this is a master who hasn't mastered themselves. And what do I mean about a master who hasn't mastered themselves? Well, if I am known to be the greatest of all time, some may say that part of my work is to now give the gifts that I've mastered to the next person, to hand the, pass the baton. But if the master has not mastered the fear of being topped, that the pupil has potential to outshine the master, they may prevent the pupil from obtaining the tools required to be the next master, the next goat. But it also is the pupil to assess if the master has mastered their lower nature, which would be something that would hinder them from passing on the gifts because they want to remain the greatest of all time. They want that title. They don't ever want anybody to be able to say that they passed them, right? So I was thinking about Chloe and Hallie. I was thinking about these young ladies who I believe, like, when I first heard about them, it was a while ago, and I was blown away by their musical talent, their musical ability. They're instrumentalists. I know, like, they are, I think, definitely, I think Haley, I think she plays the guitar. They might both. And I believe they might both play the piano. Their voices are amazing. They harmonize. They I would have selected them 100% to put them on. Just based off of their musical ability. These women can sing, can dance, they're talented. And one thing that's really cool is they got natural hair. And they're two of the only mainstream artists with natural hair. However, the direction that management has taken them in is not the direction that I personally would have selected for these young women. And one thing I'll say, and this is kind of the conversation is this protege type thing, this protege master type relationship, is that you have to assess the character of the master. And part of being, having your own label and part of the power is not just saying, well, sex sells, so this is what we're gonna do. It's an easy, blueprint. Sex always sells, right? Power is saying, I know sex sells, but I have the power to reshape the culture. I have the power to tell people what to like, you know? I have the power to make this sell. With that being said, as women, you know, even if you go through my lyrics, and if you go through my Instagram videos, I have lyrics that are very sensual. As a dancer, you know, sensuality is a part of our art. You know, I love to learn different types of art. As a dancer, I like to learn breakdancing. I like to learn technique and all of these things. But there also is, you know, very sensual. It can be very sensual. So I'm just gonna say that if I were to manage these young ladies, I would allow them, because I've heard them talk, and the younger one said, you know, my sister was always more of like a performer. She was always kind of more like into show, be more like showy or whatever. So when she's dancing, that's kind of been her personality. And I don't think that as an artist that you shouldn't be allowed to explore the full gamut of it. But what I will say is the industry might be oversaturated with sexuality. And to me, I don't think it's coincidental that that's the only thing that's being pushed. I say this to say balance is saying that I am a sexual being. I like to dance sensually. I like to explore my sexuality, but I like to be all encompassing as a woman. So what I would do if I was managing them is, let's say it's a 12 song album. You know, I would let them explore their sexuality for about 3 of those songs. But maybe 3 more of those songs gotta be about this. We need these type of tracks for the young ladies. 3 more of those songs gotta be about that. 3 more of those songs gotta be about that. And let them see the full gamut. And if I'm a designer, if I'm in charge of wardrobe and styling them, I'll let them wear some sexy things from time to time for a show. If you're at the, you know, VMAs or whatever, I might let you put on, you know, something a little bit more sexy. But guess what? I'm also gonna have you in a suit. I'm also gonna have you in a fly cardigan that's like really cute. You know what I mean? I'm gonna dress you in certain ways that show your full personality. You're not only there for the sensuality and sexuality and the, you know what I'm saying? To fulfill the taste buds of a man's fantasy. That's not what you're here for. Like, you are a full human being and your talent surpasses that. You can play the instruments, you can dance, you can do all of these things. We're exploring that whole thing. And now, because you all are influential and because you all have a platform, the young ladies are like, oh, this is really cool. Now men are respecting you as far as being full, well-rounded human beings and all of these things. And women are respecting you as being full, well-rounded human beings. I look at them and I say, who's the target market? Who are they singing to? Who would be buying their records? And I'm sure that there's been some backlash with the oldest one because, truthfully, if you think about it, a girl in middle school, she can't work. It's her parents that are buying her the concert tickets to go see you guys. It's her parents that are buying the, you know, the album or the streaming or whatever. And some mothers may be like, nah, that's not what I want my daughter listening to based off of the image of, you know, deep throwing a microphone. It's a little wild. Some parents may say, that's too much. I don't want my daughter, you know, copying this. So, you know, when we talk about having a platform, we also talk about social responsibility. And the social responsibility is also like, is it art imitating life or is it life imitating art? Because the girls that I imagine listen to you all, who I look at you as is, I'm right across the street from Howard University. Them. Spelman girls, you know, like I'm in a city where it's like there's so many beautiful women. A lot of them are natural haired. Like this is the environment that I'm in or whatever. And I imagine that they love you all because they see themselves in you. But when I meet a Howard girl, and this happens all the time because they always have events and things like that. And I might just go poke my head in one of those events or whatever. Like I went to a talent show that was outside by it was a bunch of Howard kids. Poke just to see what's going on the campus. And I always talk to them. We chatted up at the local little bakery and I always, they go to my gym, all these things. And so we're always talking and I love them, by the way. Like I love the Howard students. But I'm like thinking like, is this art imitating life or life imitating art? Because the Howard girls that I meet are pre-law, are pre-med, are bio, are engineering, are English majors, are PhD bound, are, you know, college professor bound. But at the talent show, they're listening to things that have that are total, like, sweetheart. I know what you do. Your lifestyle is you go to Chipotle with your friends and you hit those books. Your lifestyle is the curriculum. That's your lifestyle. What are you listening to this music? And is this your fantasy or whatever? Because you guys don't really find this that all that relatable. So we need to begin to say that as curators, pioneers, as trailblazers, as managers, A&R, stylists, all of the people who are behind pushing girls like the Baileys, you know, young women like the Baileys, we gotta also be socially aware of who is their target audience. And are we dictating a mindset that's not really all that accurate to their day-to-day lifestyle and things like that? Anyways, let me continue on my day. Much love to all the artists. Much love to all the women artists who are doing their thing. Much love to the men artists as well. And I hope that we can continue conversations much like this. Peace.